Tech giants are being accused of using your personal search data to increase the prices of items that you want to buy online. And unfortunately, what's happening here is this has turned into a whole new industry, an industry where the digital industry understands everything about you, how much money you make, where you live, what's your demographic, and they use that now to price things for you. Uber got caught doing it. They had information from Uber that says, well, we know this guy has money, so we're going to charge him more for this ride. Pick it up.
What's happening right now is that everything is connected. If you have a cell phone, if you have a laptop or a computer or anything, you get on Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, whatever it is, LinkedIn, if you're still on that. Everything is talking to each other, all of the other sites. So when you go shopping online, as most of the public does now, that organization, that company, whatever it is, their website, as soon as you log in there, they have already pulled every piece of information that is available on you. They know your race. They know your gender. They know your religion.
And why is it important? Because when you go to buy something, they know how to price it for you.
Right.
If you're going to buy an airline ticket, how many times have you gone on, check the price of an airline ticket, next thing you look at, it jumps $1,000. Airline industry got caught doing that. But look, I got to tell you, this Alternet article, I wish I knew who wrote this article. It's excellent. And they talk about this concept of behavioral advertising. And in here, whoever wrote this, I mean, he or she says, look, you know, I'm okay if I'm going to go buy a new bike and all of a sudden I'm inundated with different kinds of bikes.
Right.
But I'm really bothered by when that bike comes in, they understand I'm part of the affluent America, therefore I'm going to charge more because I know all of your demographics. I know where you vacationed. I know what kind of home you live in. So I know I can charge you more for that bike. This rider nails this so well. It's in Alternet. It's called how big tech is springing in your wallet. You know, how are they spying on your wallet?
Well, to me, what's really remarkable here is the fact that this is not technically legal. We're talking about price discrimination. You know, if you live up north, you're going to pay more for something like snow tires than you would in the south. And it's not a supply and demand issue. It's because they can. So when you break those basic economic rules, I know they're not legal laws, but when you break those basic economic rules, you do run the chance of running afoul of the law and saying we're charging more just because we think we know where you're located, or we saw that you purchased a ticket to go snow skiing, but you live in Miami,
yeah.
So you may want to buy these snow tires. We're jacking up the price for you for this one-time purchase.
This Alternet author, again, this is wonderful work. This is very, very good journalism right here. Says that, he says, for example, in the past, salesmen have had to go through this qualifying process. Can you afford this? Should I try to sell you this upper-end car, middle-level car, low-end car? They say now they have all the information. They know, matter of fact, there's already statistics that if a white male presents to buy a car, they'll work more with that white male, believing that they're just more astute, that they're going to know what a good deal and a bad deal is. But if a female goes in to buy the car, they're going to jack it up, see what they can get away with. It's the same thing.
Right.
They want to know everything about you, so when they price things for you, they even give a great example. This is, again, well-written article. They talk about the fact that the healthcare, if you take healthcare as a prime example, if you go in and you're uninsured and you want simply an x-ray, they're going to charge you 20 times what they're going to charge to Medicare or Medicaid or the insurance company. Why? Because they can get away with it.
And what we're going to see moving forward, you know, you brought up the issue of the car dealerships, which they already do that now. But we're going to see other companies where people have to physically walk in. They're going to start using this data as well, especially if it's something you look online, but then you have to go into a showroom, whether it's for a car or for furniture. They're going to have all your data already. You're going to lose any ability you may have had as a consumer to negotiate on price, to do any kind of, you know, haggling in areas where you're allowed to do it. And that's the next step. And people have to understand, You may think that, oh, well, no, 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 my Facebook, I don't allow it to talk to these other apps. We know, because it's been exposed, it's still happening.
Okay, give me the example of the airlines. You want to buy an airline ticket. Right. You used to have a way you could avoid them jacking it up, right?
Right, right.
Not anymore.
The advice was always clear your browsing history before you go back and look at a ticket again, because you'll avoid the price increase, and that was true. But now you can't do that, because maybe you've posted on Facebook, hey, looking forward to going to Vegas in 5 weeks. They know. Right. They get that information. They see your search history.
They know the hotels you've stayed in. If you stayed at the Wynn, pretty upper end, we're not going to charge him more. If you vacationed in the Bahamas or Bermuda, well, this person can afford a lot,
right,
so we're going to jack the price up. Okay, who has that information? This is where they nail it. Uber has that information. Airbnb has that information. These dominant corporations understand they're absolutely dependent on this information, and they can actually jack up prices according to that information. And we know this for a fact. The airlines have this information. They know everything that's going on in your life, and they do this in a way to where the FTC is useless. FTC, there's no laws that say, you know what, you can get away with this. Now, if it's the worst of the worst, maybe they'll sometimes pay attention. But run of the mill, no, behavioral advertising is the thing that we all have to deal with right now. And some of us pay more money because of it.
And I tell you, Elizabeth Warren is spot on when she says we have to break up these tech giants, because they may all be different companies, but every one of them is working with the other one to get your data and use it to make you pay more money. She is spot on.
Doing the same thing. Thanks, Farron. Thanks for joining me.
Thank you.
A self-help guru groomed women for sex, subjecting them to shame and humiliation, and threatened to expose their deepest secrets if they didn't comply with his wishes. RT correspondent Brigida Santos has the full story. Brigida, it's almost like you can't push the limits in weird and stories anymore. What are the prosecutors alleging in this case against Keith Raniere?
The prosecutors are accusing Keith Raniere of creating an organization known as Nexium that was advertised as a professional self-help coaching and educational business, but actually operated more like an expensive pyramid scheme / master-slave sex cult. During ongoing trial proceedings, the assistant U.S. attorney has described the Nexium leader as a predator who sexually exploited women, often humiliating and blackmailing them with collateral, which came in the form of naked photos or damaging secrets. One of the females Raniere reportedly exploited and sexually engaged with was actually underage. And last week, a witness testified that Raniere also psychologically manipulated and broke his followers through near-starvation diets, forced sex, and isolation. Now, he reportedly labeled anyone who questioned him and his teachings a suppressive person and encouraged his followers to distance themselves from these so-called bad influences. This is something straight out of the cult playbook.
So, Brigida, you know, it sounds like we hear these stories again and again. It honestly does. You know, the stories about whether it's the Scientology church, whether it's the Mormon church, whether it's the Catholic church. If you look at all the similarities, you kind of have that cult factor that people are saying more and more. You're hearing that. Well, it's a cult environment. And there's always co-defendants in those cases. You know, there's other people that are part of it. Are there co-defendants in this case with Raniere?
Now, he currently stands trial alone, but five other Nexium members were formally charged with a laundry list of crimes last year, including extortion, forced labor, sex trafficking, money laundering, and obstruction of justice, among a few of other ones. Those who have since pleaded guilty include Smallville actress Allison Mack, Seagram's heiress Claire Bronfman, and Nexium's former accountant. Several of these women are now expected to testify against Raniere during the ongoing trial.
Brigida, you've handled similar stories that we've done in the past. What is the draw here? How does somebody just abandon all sense of common sense? I mean, how is it that it's almost a suspension of disbelief? How are they brought in? It's almost like the mentality that I see is like the human trafficking cases that I'm handling right now. We see that a lot, how people are pulled into this. If you were to pinpoint what happens, what happens here? How are they pulled into this? Is it just it's got to be a well-organized scheme?
Yeah, so a lot of these people are already searching for answers. You know, they're going to him looking for self-help. They want to pay fees to take classes that they think that they're going to gain something out of that's going to make their life better. And then you have these famous people like Allison Mack, that actress from a CW show, I believe it was, called Smallville. You know, she's famous. She's drawing in young other women who look up to her, and she's now part of the scheme. And so they just bring in more and more people who are looking for answers and are susceptible to falling prey to this kind of figure, this leader.
You know, yeah, you know what I see sometimes too, is sometimes the prosecutors look at this and they say, these are accomplished people. They don't have any reason to be in weird world, is the only way you can describe this, or to drive this program that seems to be nothing less than human trafficking, really, when you drill down on it. And so prosecutors and law enforcement don't pay as much attention to it, and they get away with it for a lot longer. Listen, thanks for joining me. I'm dying to see how this goes in a courtroom.
Every year, 1 million hernia surgeries are performed in the United States. Unfortunately, some mesh implants that are used in these surgeries have caused complications, including infection and organ damage that led to surgeries to correct those problems. If this has happened to you, learn more about the hernia mesh lawsuit by going online to hernia.law or call us for a free consultation about your legal rights.